You said last time, Graham, that we should spend all our time on this programme just looking at questions. Let's start off with a very important one. If God is all-powerful, as you've been saying, why doesn't he exercise more control over this world? Why is there so much pain, suffering and evil?
Well, he certainly could if he wished to. He could even have made us all robots. It seems to me this is all part of the price of freedom. We have an infinitely powerful God who could do anything he wished, except he can't force freedom. And so in order to have freedom, he restrains his use of power. When you think how much we would like to help the people in Ethiopia, and even in this country, think how much God must wish he could. Mm-hmm. We don't have the power to do it. He does. I marvel at God's restraint in not using his power, rather than wondering why he doesn't use it more.
That's one that's very hard to understand, isn't it?
Yes, yes.
And again, you said that God is infinitely gracious, and he is a very caring and loving God. But right back in the Garden of Eden, he said to Adam and Eve, if you eat this, you'll die. Now, not even a parent would say that to their child.
No, my parents never said that to me. In the day you eat thereof, I'll kill you. Of course, did God say, in the day you eat thereof, I'll kill you? And observers have wondered all through the years what God really meant by that. What would he do to his children if they should disobey him? And as we were discussing earlier, I think this is one of the great meanings of why Jesus had to die. He died to show what God will do if we go our own rebellious, disorderly way. He will give us up as he gave up his son. So I think that has to be read very carefully. It's mm-hmm. not obey me or I'll kill you.
No, it's obey me or these are the consequences.
Yes.
Yeah. Then again, what about the flood that is brought up so often? God wiped out the whole population of this world except for 8 people. How could a loving God do that?
Yeah, that used to make me wonder as a boy, particularly because there was a large red book in our home with vivid pictures of Old Testament events. And one of them was a picture of the flood, and it showed the last high, dry peak, and there was a tigress with her cubs, and there were parents with their children, all struggling for that last dry spot. And I knew that the water would keep rising and rising, and eventually they'd all be gone. I mean, how could God do such a thing? And when little children read the story, they're sure that gentle Jesus, meek and mild, wouldn't mm-hmm. do it. And so they begin to think, well, it must be that other one up there, that fearsome one, the one we call God. He's the one who would drown all but 8. Until we learn that the Father is just as loving as the Son. So I have to go back and reconstruct the situation again, the conditions in the world. Genesis says that everybody's mind was continually evil, and total rebellion against God. God almost lost contact there with the human race. What could he do? Well, one thing he knew was that the exercise of power would not win people. When the flood was all over, he hadn't won people by that demonstration of power. You think of all those folk who built the Tower of Babel afterwards. They believed in God, all right, and they believed in his power, but it terrified them, and they built the power to escape him. So, consistently with our picture of God all through the Bible, we know that he was not using force there to win people. It was another emergency measure in his far-sighted wisdom to maintain contact there with the human race. And as far as all the folk who died, I don't know what their future is. Mm. We can't say that everyone that died was wicked and that everyone who was on the boat would be saved. God saved everybody who got on the boat. And so in the resurrection, we'll find out.
Okay, let me shoot another Bible text at you that's often quoted. Whom the Lord loves, he chastens. Why does God punish people?
I used to think that the word chasten always meant punish until I learned the Greek word from which it's translated. The word, well, I pronounce it, it's paiduo. And paid is the root for a child. And the word means to instruct as a child. A good modern term would be discipline. Whom the Lord loves, he disciplines. And many of us perhaps have learned in school or at home how sometimes discipline is very much needed. I learned this at home, and in a rather dramatic way by the method my mother used to use particularly. My father was often away, traveling and speaking, and mother had a lot to do with how the six of us grew up. In our house down in Watford, in Hertfordshire, there was an entryway with that familiar piece of furniture with the mirror and the place on either side for hats and the drawer in the middle for gloves and place on either side for umbrellas. Well, in the drawer, my mother used to keep not gloves but two leather straps. I was never quite sure why she needed two. But when one of us had committed a crime that called for appropriate action, mother would march us out into the entryway there, and we knew where the site of discipline was to be. And she would sit there on the stairs, and we would assume the appropriate posture. And then mother would discuss the crime to the rhythmical swinging of this strap. And of course, the more serious the crime, the longer it took mother to discuss it, which was to our obvious disadvantage. But then mother would leave, and we would remain sitting on the bottom stair until repentance would come. Fortunately, my father liked stained glass windows, and so he had four or five, stained glass windows of ships at sea. And I'd climb up, and I'd look out through the panes of the glass as I'd wait for the pain to subside and repentance to come. Because mother never let us go out to play while we were still angry. Because while I was being disciplined, I wasn't thinking to myself how much my mother must love me to be disciplining me like this. Quite to the contrary. So I spent considerable time on the bottom stair in my life. Recently, I visited the bottom stair again. Seemed a little lower this time. But as I sat there, I felt a warm feeling, but a little higher than it used to be. It was more like up in here. As I thought of the fact that my mother had done this, I don't remember that she ever was angry when she did it. And that was a good representation of God, who disciplines those whom he loves. And as Hebrews says, at the time it may be painful, but later it yields the peaceable fruits of righteousness. So mother helped me develop the picture of God.
Let's take the opposite extreme now and think of someone who didn't seem to do anything much. Jesus said he'd be saved. I'm thinking, of course, of the thief on the cross. What did he do?
Yeah, how much did he do? Now, there's a good illustration of how one would want to take out all the Gospels and collect all that we can of the story. At first, Christ between the two thieves, and both thieves railing at Christ. And then one says to the other, we should be quiet. We're getting what we deserved. He's innocent in the middle. And something happened to the thief that led him to say to Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said, indeed I will. You will be with me in the kingdom. That doesn't seem like much, except that something had won the thief to a different attitude toward the one in the middle. He liked him. He had begun to trust him. And I've thought that there were several things that might have won the thief. In the midst of all the suffering, Jesus looked down and saw his mother. He said, John, please look after mother. Then maybe that touched the thief. Mm-hmm. But then over Jesus' head were the words, the King of the Jews. And maybe the thief thought to himself, the only kingdom where I would be safe is a kingdom presided over by a king who's acting like this one. For as Jesus, the King of the Jews, hung on the cross, he was saying to his tormentors, I forgive you, I forgive you. And the thief may have thought, that's the kind of kingdom where I'd be safe. But at least he was one to change his mind. He died trusting the one in the middle. He will arise trusting the one in the middle. And God can save all who trust him because they would be willing to listen. See, that's all God wants of us anyway. Mm-hmm.
Then a question that somebody's brought up. Divorce is mentioned in Malachi as something that God absolutely hates. And yet Moses was given permission to give the people permission to divorce if necessary.
That's true. Right there in the Old Testament, he allowed them a writ of divorcement. And one time, mm-hmm. Jesus' critics brought this matter to him and said, as usual, you're probably going to disagree with the Old Testament. Moses said, we may divorce. What do you say? And Jesus said, well, from the beginning it was not like this. In the beginning it was a man and a woman, and what God has joined together, let no man put asunder, the thing we say at weddings so frequently. Mm-hmm. But in Matthew, he adds, the reason why I gave you the permission to divorce was because of the stiffness of your necks and the hardness of your hearts. Or as some versions say, because you were so hard to learn. That's as far as God could go. See, in Old Testament times, if you're tired of your wife, you could just dismiss her. And God said through Moses, don't do that anymore. I can't make you love your wives and stay with them, but at least dismiss them with some measure of dignity. Preserve their reputation. Give them a writ of divorcement. But the ideal is, what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. So it's an emergency measure, mm-hmm. God meeting people where they are, leading them no faster than they're able to follow.
Now then, we're taking another look at God. That's the title of our series. But what about those two books in the Bible that don't even mention God? How can they be of value?
That's true, Song of Solomon and Esther. Although, in some versions, God is introduced, though he's not in the original language. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe take just one of them. The book of Esther doesn't mention God, and nobody seems to pray. And yet, when you put the book of Esther in the setting, when so many of the Jews were in captivity, at the end of the 70 years that Jeremiah had predicted, they had a chance to go home. Some of them went. Many of them stayed. How do you think God would treat those who didn't care enough, didn't have enough faith to go back to the promised land? Mm. The book of Esther describes how God looked after those Jews who didn't care enough to go home. Sometimes we say God only looks after good people. No, he looks after us when we need being looked after.
And then what about this question that's come to mind? It's the result of a recent poll in a national newspaper that asked, what question would you ask about God? And one of the frequent questions was about the future. What does the future hold? What do we have to look forward to? Perhaps you can give some sort of response from the Bible perspective.
Well, I know a lot is said about the danger of our blowing ourselves into oblivion.
That's right.
And so on, and we apparently have the power to do it. But as I go through the 66, I don't find that described. In Isaiah, for example, there are marvelous pictures of everything being restored in the end. Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you, and I will come again. And all the pictures in Revelation, the last two chapters. It might seem that we're about to do it, but the climax in the Bible seems to be the second coming of Christ and all the great events that follow. So while I think we should take seriously the present dangers that we face, there's no reason to be pessimistic that we're actually going to destroy ourselves entirely. God has indicated there is triumph rather than defeat in the end.
So there's hope, not despair.
Exactly.
That's what you're saying.
That's right.
Very good. In that same poll, it asked the question about the people's own beliefs, and it revealed that, of course, few of them went to church, and few of them read their Bibles. In your time that you've spent over here in England, why do you think that is?
Well, I've asked several people since we got here. We asked a lady the other day, and she used the word disillusionment. Mm-hmm. And we didn't have time to ask her what she meant, but we have talked to some who look wistfully at grander days in the past. Well, I remember when I grew up as a boy in Watford and attended the grammar school there. One day my father took me down to see HMS Hood. What a battleship that was before the Bismarck blew it up. I remember how we felt when we got the news of that. I remember walking on the deck and we stood under those huge guns in the forward turret there, and I thought how the sun never set on the British Empire. Those were great days in the past when Britain was very much involved, too, in the circulation of the Bible. And religion seemed to be a matter of much more general interest. I wonder if we have allowed many changes that have come to perhaps discourage us and divert our attention too much to ourselves and away from the best good news of all, which is the truth about God, which can only be found in the Bible. And you think what England has done through the years to make the Bible available, not just in English, but in many of the other languages of earth. Perhaps, and it'll have to be freely done, more and more of us could return to the regular reading of the scriptures and the worship and admiration that goes along with that, that great days might return.
Mm. And now, how would you encourage people to open their Bibles? How would you set about encouraging them to just take the Bible, open it, and read it?
That's a very practical question, because some, say, might start in Genesis and get along very well. They have many interesting stories, and then soon they're into genealogies and other apparently more obscure passages.
That's right. What is the best place to
so,
start?
So, with some, I suggest starting with John. Mm-hmm. I mean, such a magnificent picture of God, and told very simply. I mean, even the Greek is simple, which results in the translations being very readable of the Gospel of John. There's no rule as to where one should start. But if one has not had much experience reading the Bible, I would suggest starting with the clearest revelation of all, provided by Jesus himself, as recorded in the four Gospels. I think I'd recommend that.
Starting with the Gospels.
Yes.
Okay. And how about the best way to read it, thinking practically? Is it best to read it alone, or in a group, or in the family? Or how do you do it?
Well, sometimes I like to read alone, but sometimes the most stimulating thing of all is to read with other people. And if one can find congenial friends to do it with, the safest way of all to read the Bible is in company with others. And then one is sure not to overlook something. That's one of the great benefits of our groups. I might overlook a passage and someone else will say, well, what about that story of the Levite and his concubine in Judges 19? Mm-hmm. So we don't look over anything. Or if we might have seemed to give a rather superficial answer to a question, there might be someone in the room who has his doctorate in physics, and he will say that seemed a little lacking in reasoning and evidence. A good mix is wonderful. But maybe the largest group that's congenial is your own family. And it makes a wonderful thing to do for daily devotion, to just go slowly through the Bible, book by book and story by story. I found the children love to do it. I've done it with my own, and my grandchildren now are getting ready.
Mm-hmm. Do you have any special recommendations for studying with children? Any particular ways you can adapt the Bible so they can understand it?
Well, we ask them to read the next amount, the next stories, and to keep in mind the question, what does this say about God? And then we ask them, like the flood question that you asked me, I mean, what kind of a God would drown all but eight? Now, the important thing is not to get all tied up in such questions as, how did God get all the animals in the ark? The big question is, what kind of a God would actually do such a thing? So one has to form this habit of asking the question, what does this say about God? I've sometimes maybe initiated a group at some distance from home, and then a few days later I get a telephone call, or a few weeks later, what was that question? What was that question? I say, you mean, what does this say about God? That's the essential one to raise continually. And it works beautifully with children. I almost think they do it best of all, and they're so uninhibited in the observations they make, and they're totally unafraid to ask questions.
And once you've started, how do you go on? Once you've made that start, maybe in the Gospels, perhaps, or maybe in Genesis, how do you proceed? How do you continue? And perhaps you could comment on the best time of day and how often and so on.
Well, I think it's a very individual matter, and I must say that one of the most important things is to get a Bible that you enjoy reading. For example, some of the ones we looked at the other day. Now, we've mentioned only a few. In my office at home, there are many, many yards of Bibles to choose from. And of the ones we've talked about, or, for example, this magnificent Good News Bible. It's so readable. It's so inexpensive. I don't know how the Bible societies print them for this price. But, of course, they're absolutely dedicated to making the Bible readily available. And, of course, there's Phillips alongside, and, of course, the New International Version. And someone of scholarly inclination might like to get the whole Anchor Bible, all 60. And of course, the beautiful New American Bible, the Catholic one, and the Jerusalem Bible. As I mentioned before, go into a Christian bookshop and look over the books there and pick them up. And if it seems hard to read, put that one down and pick up another one. There's such a variety. And if price is a problem, there are paperbacks of such modest cost, almost unbelievably low in price, that really the Bible is available in readable form to everybody. That would be the first thing. But then when starting through, keep reminding yourself, what does this say about God? What does this say about God? Until that becomes a habit.
Now, in your statement, you say that God is not the kind of person his enemies have made him out to be. Why do you emphasize his enemies? Why are they important?
You raise a good point there, because I believe that some who may not have a really true picture of God are not his enemies. You could say God is not the kind of person some have made him out to be. It's just that in the Bible there is mention of an enemy and enemies. There is that accuser of God who accused him in Job, mm-hmm. and accused him in Revelation, and accused him in Zechariah. The one who, right in the first story in the Bible, the story of creation, accused God of lying to Adam and Eve. God had said, you will die. Not I'll kill you, but I'll give you up and you'll die. The devil said, that's a lie. You won't die. Now, who would have faith in a liar? And so, since the enemy and other enemies who've joined with him have indeed sought to put God in a bad light, I sometimes include that in the statement.
Perhaps we can just take another one here at the moment, another text that people bring up, the one about vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, I will repay.
That's a good one. Vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. I have some folk who enjoy that verse. Mm. I think of an individual right now I often have discussions with on this matter, because she says, if God will not take vengeance on those who have done me wrong, mm-hmm. then I will not respect him. I think the reason why God says, don't you take vengeance on yourselves, leave it up to me, is that God loves our enemies. You see, our enemies, upon whom we'd like to wreak vengeance, mm-hmm. our enemies are also God's children. And so when God takes vengeance on them, that would be more like discipline. Whom the Lord loves, and he loves his bad children too, whom the Lord loves, he disciplines. Now, there's one hazard to this. If you allow God to take vengeance on our enemies, which will be in the form more of discipline because he wants to win them, there is the hazard that he might win them, which means that in the kingdom, we might meet our former enemies. Mm-hmm. And we've been hoping that God has destroyed them. And so it would be rather interesting to meet an enemy in the kingdom to our surprise and then run to God and say, that's not fair. I counted on you to take vengeance. Oh, he said, are you disappointed that I won your enemy? I'm not sure you're in the right place, you know. Yeah. So I think it's much safer to let God take vengeance for us, because in taking vengeance, he might win a former enemy. And I doubt we're safe to save if we're not willing to welcome former enemies back as our friends.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned a phrase there just that popped up, being safe to save. How are we safe to save?
Oh, I like that. It seems to me all through the Bible there's only one requirement for salvation mentioned repeatedly, and that's trust in God. That's a genuine trust, which means a willingness to listen. And that's just not an idle willingness to listen. I hear you, but I'm busy. It's a willingness to listen and carry out as best we can what he's advised us to do. Now, anyone who trusts God like that and is willing to listen, God can save and heal. And that kind of a person would be safe to admit to the kingdom.
In your statement, just let's go back to that now, and perhaps I can ask you to tell it us one more time before we close. What really encapsulates your idea there? What is the most important thing you want to say through that statement?
Do you want me to say it again or summarize it?
Well, perhaps summarize it and then say it for us.
Well, in the Bible, God's power is emphasized, and some just stress the power. And then there are all the pictures of love and gentleness and his being so forgiving, and some stress that. And I think that is not a full representation. The Bible speaks of his power, indeed so, but it speaks of his graciousness, that he's so forgiving. And if I'm really taking the Bible as a whole, if I follow what that verse says, all scripture inspired of God is profitable, I'm not going to stress the power over against the kindness and the mm-hmm. love, and I'm not going to stress the love and kindness over against the power. I'm going to see a God who has both. And then the other thing is, that he doesn't just say I'm powerful, he doesn't just say I'm loving, he demonstrates his power incredibly. and he demonstrates his graciousness so convincingly. And then that's the basis for the position that a person can take about God.
Well, that seems to sum it all up. I'd like you now, if you just take a little time, to go over that statement with us again so that we can perhaps catch it in our mind just one more time. Perhaps you can give that to us one more time.
I believe that God is an infinitely powerful... Oh, maybe I'd start back a little further. I believe that God is not the kind of person some, even his enemies, have made him out to be. Arbitrary, vengeful, and severe. Though infinite in majesty and power, he is an equally gracious person who values nothing higher than the freedom, the dignity, and the individuality of his intelligent creatures, that their love, their faith, their worship, their willingness to listen and obey may be freely given. This is the truth I find in all 66 books of Scripture. And this, I believe, is what the Bible describes as the everlasting good news that wins and holds the admiration and trust of God's loyal children throughout the universe. Of course, having said that, as Paul learned to say, let everyone be fully persuaded in his own mind.